This is an interesting church. Wonderful children's sermon. And it says something about who we are, about how God works in our hearts and our lives. And I'm so thankful for all the activity that takes place. And that's led by the Holy Spirit, our mission work, the team to Appalachia, and also our team to Mountaintop in Nicaragua. And I hope that you'll do all you can to support them and to help them in that effort, because I think it's something that can change our lives and guide us as we're open to that Spirit. As Susan mentioned, today is Pentecost Sunday, and if you've been coming to church very long, you would think I would be reading from Acts, the second chapter. That's normally that passage of Scripture that is read. But today I'm going to take the epistle lectionary and read from Romans, the eighth chapter, beginning at verse 22. We know that the whole creation has been groaning in labor pains until now. And not only the creation, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we groan inwardly while we wait for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope, for who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. The word of God for the people of God. Today is Pentecost, and it is a special day. And you're going to see the red parapets and the red stole for several weeks as we celebrate this season of Pentecost. And we in the church, I think, have gotten away from a proper understanding of what Pentecost is all about. Because unfortunately, the word Pentecost is closely related to the word Pentecostalism. And Pentecostalism deals with emotion, with exuberance, with excitement, with people shouting, with people running the aisles, with people showing their faith, with people being happy and people expressing their love in an open and wonderful way. And we Methodists want nothing of it. We want quiet, peace, solitude. We want to be left alone. We don't want anything to disturb us out of that solitude that we so cherish. And so when it comes to Pentecost and Pentecost Sunday, it's hard for us to understand exactly what God is trying to do in our hearts and our lives. But I think Pentecost is crucial and important. In fact, John Wesley preached about the doctrine of sanctification and how the Holy Spirit fills our hearts and our lives and guides us in our living. Now, last Sunday, we brought in the confirmation class. And we told them, as we told everyone that was here Sunday, that confirmation is not the end of the journey, it is simply the beginning of a journey. It is our way of living as God is guiding and leading us in life. It is being open to how God will lead these young confirmands throughout the rest of their life in their Christian discipleship. And we too are on that same journey. Fortunately, God does not leave us alone. God does not say, you are at point A, and I want you to be at point B when you die. Get there any way you can. God doesn't say that. God provides for us a way in which we can get from point A to point B, and point B being sainthood, the righteous life, the disciple of Christ, someone who is fulfilled by God's presence and love in a wonderful way. We get there through the guidance and direction of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit guides us in our lives. Now, in a few hours in Indianapolis, someone is going to say, start your engines, and the race of the year will begin. It is a journey around that track, 500 miles, as they run that race. It's a time of excitement as they're doing all that they're doing. And I know you're not big NASCAR fans or Formula Ones or whatever the race is. You can tell how much I know about it. But it's a journey, even if it's around the circle. It's still a travel, it's still a journey. Well, we are on our Christian life, and when the Holy Spirit comes to us, it's as if we start the journey, we start the engines, we start the power, and we're ready to go. But unfortunately, we're not on a racetrack, or at least we shouldn't be. We shouldn't be going around in circles. We should be making progress. We should be going somewhere. We should be growing in our maturity. So as the Holy Spirit guides us and leads us in our lives, we find ourselves on this journey. Now, how many of you have a GPS? You know, you use the GPS, and I love these television commercials where the woman is following the GPS and she drives off a cliff. Now, why do I love that? I guess it's the realization that we come to the place where we lose our ability to think that we would actually allow a GPS to tell us to drive off a cliff, and we would do it. Well, the Holy Spirit's not that way. If you think the Holy Spirit's going to tell you what to do and when to do it, it's not going to happen that way. The Holy Spirit, the Scripture says, is like a wind. It comes and it goes. You don't know when it'll appear, and you don't know what it will ask you to do. You may have already been challenged by the Holy Spirit this morning to do something that you normally would not have done, but perhaps Harold or Amanda or the music that we've heard or the prayers that were prayed, something was said, and you thought, why can't I do that? Why couldn't I meet that challenge? That's the Holy Spirit, perhaps, speaking to you about what you need to do, about what you can do in your life. So we're on this journey. The Holy Spirit is leading us. We're moving toward maturity, but we're surrounded by a world filled with sin. We're already and still at the same time. We're in the already, but still we're hoping for more. Now, the best way to illustrate that is to realize that there is a difference between where we are and where we want to be. And all we have to do is listen to our television, radio, or read a newspaper or magazine and to realize what kind of world that we live in. I've seen newscasts and I would thought, how can we in America, the richest nation in the world, still have children in poverty? How can we do that? How can we have homeless people in our world when we have so much material possessions, we have the ability, we could solve so many problems? And yet poverty and homelessness continue to grow. The needs of people are always present. Illnesses that strike us, the diseases that we deal with, the problems that come to us, even when we think we've been isolated and insulated enough from all of those things, still they find us and we deal with them. And we struggle. As Scripture says, we groan. We live in a world that has too many wars. They're killing the children in Syria, and we can't stop it. We go into Afghanistan and we can't get out. We're living in a world where our politicians tell us what we want to hear, and unfortunately, we're silly enough to believe them. And they get what they want, and we get what's left over. We live in a world between where we are and where we want to be. And if you've never read a newspaper, if you've never listened, then you don't understand what I'm talking about. But if you're aware of the conflict in our world, if you're aware of what we're facing as a society, you realize that we're facing difficult issues, difficult situations. We are where we are, but we're not where we want to be. Have you ever heard the expression, ignorance is bliss? It is. Sometimes I wish I were more ignorant, and I'm pretty ignorant in some things, but ignorance is bliss. If you don't know anything, if you never ask a question, you're going to be happy. If you believe everything that everyone tells you and you simply follow what they tell you to do, you'll never go anywhere, but you'll be happy. The Holy Spirit isn't that kind of spirit. Because you see, when the Holy Spirit comes into our hearts and our lives and we start this Christian journey, we start dealing with who we are. And maybe our attitudes, maybe our ideas about God and the church, maybe our ideas about the world, maybe our ideas about politics are going to have to change. Because when the Holy Spirit really gets a hold of us, we're not going to turn him into a Republican or a Democrat. He'll turn us into a Christian. And there's a difference. You see, the Holy Spirit is going to challenge us in the way that we live. The world says it's what you show to everyone else. It's impressing your neighbor. It's doing what everyone else is doing. It's having the latest gadget. It's going on all the experiences that we go on. It's doing all of these things. And none of those in themselves are bad, as long as we keep a proper perspective. That our ultimate purpose of living is not to be a selfish consumer of resources. Our ultimate purpose of living is to be a disciple for Christ and to help build his kingdom here on earth. And when we do that, that means all of us are involved in missions, and all of us are involved in giving, and all of us are doing what God would ask us to do. This past week, I was listening to a newscast where they were saying that the Pacific Ocean now has enough garbage in it the size of some states floating in the ocean. And I groaned. That's not where we need to be. That's not the kind of world God wants us to live in. And so we deal with the already, but we still have hope for what could be. And our hope is an expectant hope. Just as a mother goes into labor to bring forth the birth of a child, and while that labor may be intensive and painful and strong, the moment of delivery erases all the pain and all the struggle. Now, if you already have the answers to your life already figured out, and it's called an IRA, Social Security, and enough of a pension to live comfortably, if you already have all the answers to your life figured out, then you're not groaning, and you're not expectant. The expectancy is when we realize how God is at work in our lives, changing our world, changing us to change our world. And so we struggle with what that means. And we work as diligently as we can to see how God can use us to build his kingdom. And so it is that we wait with expectancy. We wait with that sense of hope. And it is a hope that helps us to see how God can work in ways that we've never experienced before. Because you see, sometimes we rely upon program to move people along in the journey when it's the Spirit of God that moves us. You're not going to do something because I ask you to. Ultimately, you'll do what God asks you to do, I hope, and you'll respond to God. So we're struggling, we're groaning, but we're waiting with hope. We're waiting patiently, but we're also waiting with endurance. And that word patience in verse 25 really is translated, or should be translated, that we're waiting with endurance. We're waiting with the day in, the day out, the go to work, the get it done. You know, sometimes I get discouraged. I get discouraged when I see where we are as a church and where we could be. And I'm groaning as I understand that if we would simply understand how God is at work in our hearts and our lives, how we could move forward. But we wait with patience and we wait with endurance and we move forward and we continue the work that God has given us to do. And so I show up for work every Monday morning, doing what I can to be a faithful Christian, a faithful pastor. We used to sing a song in the church entitled, "We'll Work Till Jesus Comes. We'll Work." Well, that should be our call. We'll work till Jesus comes. We'll be on this journey. We'll be going where the wind blows us, where the wind directs us. We'll never know exactly what's going on, but we will be going on this journey, and God will be guiding us and leading us in a wonderful, wonderful way. And we'll do it because of the power of Pentecost, because of the Holy Spirit that comes into our hearts and our lives and blesses us. Now, I read the story of a man from Chicago that went down below the Dixon-Mason line. He went to Georgia, and he was going to stay for a few days, and so he would go out every morning and eat breakfast. First morning he went out, he ordered breakfast, and they set this bowl of white stuff right next to his plate. He had no idea what that was, and so he said, what's this? And the waitress said, "Honey, those are grits." Now, when my wife's not affectionate enough to me, I always go to a restaurant or a convenience store where I will be referred to as honey, darling, dear, sweetie. I mean, they do that for some reason. So he goes in the next day, and he gets another bowl of grits. And he asks the question, "What's a grit?" And the waitress said, "Darling, there's no such thing as a grit. They all come together. They're grits." There's no such thing as a solitary Christian. We are called into the family of God as brothers and sisters to gather in Christ. And we're empowered by the Holy Spirit to be His church. And we're to be in ministry to our world through that power. And we can't do it by ourselves. Every single one of us together, powered by the Holy Spirit and led by His grace, can make a difference in our world. We are not alone. God's Spirit is with us and within us. And God's Spirit continues to guide us and lead us. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.